6 minute English from BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to 6 minute English. I'm Neil.
And I'm Catherine.
Catherine, I'm going to start this program with a quick test just for you.
Oh, I love tests.
Complete this phrase. Wake up and smell the...
Coffee! Coffee, Neil, it's coffee. I have to say, I love coffee. Mm. It's great.
Yeah, OK. So do you drink much?
Well, just a couple of cups, you know.
Every day?
No, every hour. I love coffee. Don't you like coffee, Neil?
I do. Maybe not as much as you. What's the best thing about it?
Oh, it's the smell. It's got to be the smell. You know, when you open the packet, it's great, isn't it?
Yes, but it never quite tastes as good as it smells, does it?
Well, no, not really. It's always a bit disappointing. I live in hope. Another cup, I think it'll be better. I might change brands, actually, and try a different one.
Yeah, OK. You've had quite a lot of coffee today, haven't you?
Just my usual 6 cups.
Well, our topic is the smell of coffee, and coffee is also the subject of today's question. The world's biggest producer of coffee is...
Brazil! Brazil!
Yes, but that's not the question. The question is, Brazil is the biggest coffee producer, which is the second largest coffee producing country. Is it A, Colombia, B, Vietnam, or C, Ethiopia?
Right, so it's not Brazil, but I bet it's another South American country. So I'm going to go for Colombia. Colombia, is that right?
OK, we'll have the answer later in the programme, by which time maybe the caffeine will have left your body, Catherine. Tim Hayward is a coffee shop owner. He appeared in the BBC Radio 4 programme, The Kitchen Cabinet. How important does he say the smell of coffee is?
Absolutely vital. It's the key thing. And you, when you walk into the coffee shop in the morning and that smell hits you, you're getting physiological responses.
So how important is it?
I'm feeling a bit calmer now. Tim Hayward says the smell of coffee is vital. That means it's very important. It's perhaps the most important thing. And he backs this up by saying that it's the key thing. Something that's key is essential. It's really important.
And he says that when you experience the smell, when the smell hits you, you get a physiological response. This phrase means your body has a reaction to the smell of coffee. Perhaps your mouth begins to water in anticipation. Catherine, when you get a coffee, do you normally have it there or take it away?
Well, I usually take it away. Although, if I'm feeling really in need of a coffee hit, I might have one there and then get another one to take with me.
Can you describe the container that you're given when you have a coffee to go?
Yes, it's in a tall paper cup with a lid. And the lid has a hole in it so that I can drink that lovely coffee.
Don't you think that's a problem? I mean, we know how important the smell is, so what's the effect of the lid on that experience?
The effect of the lid?
Yeah, well, here's Tim Hayward again, talking about coffee being served with lids.
What baffles me is how many of the large coffee chains actually sell a product in a cup that removes the smell. So you walk into the coffee shop, you get the smell, but when you actually take the drink out, you're drinking it from something that's designed to deliver the hot liquid directly past your tongue, but stop any smell coming up to your nose. That's just weird.
So what is it he's describing there?
I see, yes. He's talking about the big coffee chains. A chain is a company that has lots of its stores in towns and cities, sometimes around the world. I think we can all think of a few well-known coffee chains. And he says that by putting a lid on takeaway cups, you're actually blocking the smell. That smell that is really important to the coffee experience.
Yes, and he says he finds that weird, which is a way of saying he finds it unusual, thinks it's strange, odd. So much so that he says it baffles him. If you are baffled by something, you find it confusing. You can't really understand it. Here's Tim Hayward again.
What baffles me is how many of the large coffee chains actually sell a product in a cup that removes the smell. So you walk into the coffee shop, you get the smell, but when you actually take the drink out, you're drinking it from something that's designed to deliver the hot liquid directly past your tongue, but stop any smell coming up to your nose. That's just weird.
That was coffee shop owner Tim Hayward. Right, before we have another cup of this week's vocabulary, let's get the answer to the question. After Brazil, which country produces most coffee? Is it A, Colombia, B, Vietnam, or C, Ethiopia? Catherine, you said...
I said it was A, Colombia.
Sorry, no extra coffee for you today. The answer is Vietnam. And now on to the vocabulary we looked at. Take it away, Catherine.
So the first word was vital, which is an adjective that means very important. And another word with a very similar meaning was key, meaning essential.
Next, we had the phrase physiological responses. Physiological refers to what our bodies do, and a response is a reaction. So a physiological response is a reaction your body has to something, like the smell of coffee.
Something that baffles you, confuses you. You don't understand it.
You might find something that baffles you to be weird. This adjective means unusual or strange.
And finally, a chain is a group of shops from the same company with the same name.
Well, that is the end of our programme. For more from us, check out Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube and our app. And of course, the website, bbclearningenglish.com. See you soon. Goodbye.
Bye. Fancy a coffee?
I think you've had too much.
6 Minute English from BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to 6 Minute English. I'm Dan and joining me today is Catherine. Hey, Catherine.
Hey, Dan.
So, Catherine, do you prefer a brew or a cup of joe in the morning?
Ah, well, if you're referring to whether I prefer a cup of tea, which we sometimes call a brew, or a cup of coffee, sometimes called a cup of joe, I prefer my coffee in the morning.
I only drink coffee when I really need to wake up quickly.
And why are you asking, Dan?
Because it's part of this 6 Minute English.
Coffee, I see. So how do you take it then, Dan?
Well, I'm an instant coffee kind of guy, and I like mine with a dash of milk. How about you?
A dash of something is a small amount of something, especially liquid. Personally, I prefer freshly ground coffee beans and I like my coffee dark and strong, preferably Colombian or maybe Brazilian.
Wow, a coffee aficionado, eh?
An aficionado is a person who's very enthusiastic about or interested in a particular subject.
Well, let me test your knowledge with this week's quiz question. The speciality coffee Kopi Luwak is made from coffee beans which have already passed through an animal's digestive system. But which animal? Is it A, an elephant, B, a cat, or C, a weasel?
I'm always going to answer B, a cat. Did you say this coffee actually goes through the animal, as in it eats it and then it comes out the other end and that's what we use for the coffee?
Well, yes, it is actually one of the most expensive coffees in the world. Anyway, we'll find out if you're right or not later on. So, talking of expensive, do you tend to pay more for your coffee or are you happy with the cheapest chips stuff?
Cheapest chips means very cheap. And personally, I do actually like a quality product and I am willing to pay a bit more for it.
Would you be willing to pay even more than you already do if it meant that the farmer who grew the beans was getting a fairer price?
I would, because I think that that sort of thing is important.
And you aren't alone. There's a growing trend among many Western customers of artisan cafes to be willing to pay more for ethically produced coffee.
Ethical means morally right. So, Dan, why is this trend happening at the moment?
Well, it's probably been going on for a while. But a new report from the UN's World Intellectual Property Organization has observed the effect that smarter processing, branding and marketing has had on the farmers and their communities.
And because of this, coffee drinkers are better able to choose ethically produced coffee that puts more money in the hands of the farmers. But, Dan, do the farmers actually see any of this money?
Well, it's complicated. The price of the coffee is relatively cheap until it's been roasted or cooked in an oven. As a result, roasters take most of the profits. But there is still a difference. I'll let Jonathan Josephs, a business reporter for the BBC News, explain.
For a pound of coffee beans that end up in the instant sold in supermarkets, the roaster can get over $4. But the export price is just $1.45. The farmer gets most of that. But when the new wave of socially aware customer pays a premium for higher standards, the roaster can get $17.45. But the export price also rises to $5.14.
A premium is an amount that's more than usual. So the farmer makes 3.5 times as much money.
Which means a better quality of life for the farmer, their family, and their community.
That's good news. I will definitely look for the ethically produced coffee from now on, as long as, Dan, it doesn't come out of some animal.
Yes, actually, that reminds me. Our quiz question. I asked you which animal the speciality coffee Kopi Luwak comes from. Is it A, an elephant, B, a cat, or C, a weasel?
And I said a cat.
And you were wrong, I'm afraid. Kopi Luwak comes from a type of weasel.
I'm kind of relieved about that.
Let's try not to think about it and have a look at the vocabulary instead.
OK, so first we had dash. A dash of something is a small amount of something, usually a liquid. Where might we talk about a dash of something, Dan?
Well, I like my tea with a dash of milk, my gin with a dash of tonic, and my soup with a dash of salt. Then we had aficionado. An aficionado is someone who's very interested or enthusiastic about a subject. What are you an aficionado of?
I'm working on becoming a bit of an accordion aficionado, actually, Dan.
Wow, cool.
Yeah. After that, we had cheap as chips. If something is cheap as chips, then it's very cheap indeed.
Like my shoes. I bought them at a market for next to nothing. They were as cheap as chips. Then we had ethical. Something which is ethical is morally right. Do you consider yourself to be an ethical person, Catherine?
Well, I try, Dan. I don't always get it right, but I do attempt to be. After that, we heard roasted. Roasted means cooked in an oven, like our coffee beans.
And of course, our very famous English roast. Finally, we had a premium. If you pay a premium, you pay more than usual, usually for a better quality or service. Can you think of an example?
If you're going to the cinema, you might pay a premium to get more comfortable seats.
And that's the end of this 6-Minute English. Don't forget to check out our YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram pages, and we'll see you next time. Goodbye.
Bye.
6-Minute English from BBC Learning English.
Hello, this is 6-Minute English from BBC Learning English. I'm Sam.
And I'm Neil.
Did you have a cup of coffee this morning, Neil?
Oh, yes. I can't start the day without my morning cup of coffee. Or two. Or three.
And what do you like about coffee so much?
Well, that lovely smell, for one thing. And of course, it wakes me up and gets me ready to face the world.
Ah, you mean the caffeine hit. The effect of caffeine, which is a natural stimulant on your brain, making you feel more awake. Do you think maybe you're addicted to coffee?
It's not just me, Sam. Have you seen how busy coffee shops are nowadays? Full of people enjoying delicious coffee from all around the world.
Well, it wasn't always like that, Neil. The first coffee to reach Britain in the 17th century took months to arrive by sea. It was made by boiling raw coffee beans and apparently tasted awful. In this programme, we'll be looking into the history of coffee in Britain and, as usual, we'll be learning some related vocabulary too. But before that, I have a question for you. The earliest coffee to arrive in Britain took its name from the port in Yemen it was shipped from. So, what was it called? Was it A, cappuccino, B, mocha, or C, latte?
I'll say B, mocha.
Okay, I'll reveal the answer later in the programme.
Britain's love affair with coffee started with the opening of London's first coffee shop in 1652. People loved the effect. Coffee made them more talkative and brighter. It kept them awake for longer, and the drink became more and more popular. Within a decade, over 80 new coffee shops had opened in the City of London alone.
By the 1800s, though, tea had replaced coffee as the most fashionable drink, partly because it was drunk by Queen Victoria. Listen as Judith Hawley, an expert on 18th century literature, takes up the story with BBC Radio 4 programme In Our Time.
It became more of a working class drink. So there were coffee shacks and carts, like the sort of little street carts that you get still in London, you get all over New York, that is a cheap, quick drink to perk you up. And the temperance movement sponsored coffee taverns to try to wean working men off going to the pub for lunch. So it moved, it declined seriously and has never fully recovered, even in the current coffee boom.
In the 17th century, there was a coffee boom, an increase in its popularity. One of the reasons was that coffee perks you up, gives you more energy and makes you more active.
Drinking coffee was also supported by a social group called the Temperance Movement, who campaigned to make alcohol illegal. They used coffee to wean men off alcohol, make them gradually stop using something they had become addicted to.
Coffee changed British society and continues to do so today. Here's Professor Judith Hawley again, talking to BBC Radio 4's In Our Time about the situation today.
I think if we look at the way coffee consumption is going today, it seems to me to set out two quite radical alternatives for the world. One is the world of corporate coffee, the coffee chains existing on a low-wage economy. So you have that kind of mass coffee market on the one hand. On the other hand, you have these micro-lot estates, fair trade coffee, the sort of hipster coffee, which is as varied and as interesting as fine wines, and is made in an artisanal way.
Many customers today are turning away from large coffee chains like Starbucks in search of a more responsibly sourced cup of coffee. One example of this is Fair Trade, an ethical standard scheme which guarantees a fair price for coffee producers in South America, Africa and Asia.
Another recent development is the use of microlots, small plots of land which grow specialised coffee beans prized for their high quality and unique flavour.
Fair trade and microlot coffee are part of a shift and focus towards quality, artisanal coffee. Coffee made by hand, in the traditional way, by skilled growers. It's artisanal coffee that's often sold in smaller, independent coffee shops, preferred by trendy hipsters.
So coffee in Britain has come a long way from the days it travelled for months by sea from faraway places like Ethiopia and Java. Which reminds me, Sam, what was the answer to your question?
I asked Neil which city gave its name to the first coffee to arrive in Britain in the 1600s.
I guessed it was Bean Mocha, which happens to be my favourite drink.
Well, you guessed right, because that was the correct answer. You certainly know your coffee, Neil.
Right. Let's recap the vocabulary we've used in this programme on the history of coffee, a drink which can perk you up, give you more energy and make you feel awake.
Many people drink coffee for the caffeine hit, the way caffeine, which is contained in coffee, stimulates your body and mind. The effect can be so strong, you might have to wean yourself off it, gradually stop using something which is bad for you.
Fair trade coffee refers to a scheme which ensures that coffee farmers receive a fair price for growing their product, while a microlot is a small plot of land specialising in coffee beans of a very high quality or unique flavour.
Finally, artisanal describes something made by artisans, skilled workers who make things by hand in the traditional way.
Once again, our 6 minutes are up. I'm off to get myself a hot, steamy mocha. Bye for now.
Goodbye.
6 Minute English from BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to 6 Minute English. I'm Neil.
And I'm Rob.
Now, Rob, we've talked before on this programme about our love of coffee.
Oh, yes, indeed. I couldn't function without it.
But have you ever thought about the environmental consequences of all those disposable coffee cups?
Oh, yes, indeed. I always carry a reusable cup with me, so I don't have to throw one away.
So, if a disposable cup is one you throw away, a reusable one is one that you can use again and again.
Yes, there's a big problem with disposable cups, in that many of them can't be recycled. So, there's a lot of waste for something we only use for a short time.
What are the big coffee shop chains doing about this problem? We'll find out a little bit more shortly, but first a quiz for you. Which country drinks the most coffee per capita? So not the total amount of coffee, but the average per person. Is it A, Japan, B, Kenya, or C, Finland? What do you think, Rob?
Oh, tricky. Now, I don't think the Japanese are big coffee drinkers, and I know they produce a lot of coffee in Kenya. I'm surprised the USA isn't on the list, but I'm going to go for Finland, just because.
Well, we'll see if you're right later in the programme. On a recent BBC You and Yours radio programme, they discussed the topic of coffee cups. Some of the big chains are now charging customers more for a disposable cup and giving discounts if people bring their own reusable. However, not all of the shops actually collect old cups and sort them for recycling in the shop itself. Here's Jasra Bardier from Starbucks. Is the store only interested in facilities inside their shops?
It is something that we are in the process of rolling out, and it will be in all of our stores. It's also not just our stores in which these cups end up. So we're doing a lot of work outside of our store environment to ensure that paper cups can be recycled on the go. We're working with our environmental charity partner Hubbub to increase recycling infrastructure outside of our stores, because that too is where a lot of our cups will end up.
So are they just working in their stores at improving recycling?
Well, no. After all, most people take their coffee out of the stores, so they're working on the recycling infrastructure outside as well. This will be things like bins and collection points, which are clearly marked for coffee cups.
And what about enabling recycling cups in store?
Well, she said that was something they are rolling out to all stores. Rolling out here means introducing over a period of time, so it's starting to happen, but it's not finished yet.
Let's listen again.
It is something that we are in the process of rolling out, and it will be in all of our stores. It's also not just our stores in which these cups end up. So we're doing a lot of work outside of our store environment to ensure that paper cups can be recycled on the go. We're working with our environmental charity partner Hubbub to increase recycling infrastructure outside of our stores, because that too is where a lot of our cups will end up.
Not everyone, however, believes that the coffee chains are doing everything that they can. This is Mary Cray, a member of the British Parliament. She compares the situation to that of the plastic bag charge. This was a law brought in to force shops to charge customers for plastic bags, which previously had been free.
If you think you're having to pay extra for something, as we saw with the plastic bags, we think a similar psychological measure is needed, a nudge measure, to encourage people to remember to bring their reusable cup with them. And of course, this is something that the coffee shops have been fighting tooth and nail.
She thinks that we consumers need a nudge to help us remember our reusable cups.
Yes, we need a nudge, which is a little push, a reason. In this case, she is thinking of a law to make them charge more. But she says the coffee chains really don't want this. They are, she says, fighting it tooth and nail. If you fight something tooth and nail, you're against it completely and try to stop it.
Let's hear MP Mary Cray again.
If you think you're having to pay extra for something, as we saw with the plastic bags, we think a similar psychological measure is needed, a nudge measure, to encourage people to remember to bring their reusable cup with them. And of course, this is something that the coffee shops have been fighting tooth and nail.
Time to review our vocabulary, but first let's have the answer to the quiz question. Which country drinks the most coffee per capita? Is it A, Japan? B, Kenya, or C, Finland? What do you think, Rob?
I took a bit of a guess at Finland.
Well, congratulations, your guess was correct. The Finns, on average, get through an amazing 12 kilograms of coffee a year each. Now, onto the vocabulary.
We had a couple of related but opposite words. Something disposable is designed to be used once or a few times and then thrown away. And a reusable is designed to be used again and again.
We then had rolling out, which in a business sense is the process of gradually introducing something new. This could be a new system, new product, new technology, or even a new way of doing things.
New ideas often need new infrastructure. This is usually physical structures that are needed to make something work. For example, rail infrastructure includes things like tracks, stations, and signals.
A nudge is a small push to encourage us to do something. You don't need a nudge to carry a reusable coffee cup, do you?
Oh no, I'm all for it. In fact, I'd fight tooth and nail to keep hold of my reusable, which is quite a coincidence, as that was our last expression today. To fight tooth and nail means to make a strong effort to try to stop something or achieve something.
Well, that's all from us. We look forward to your company next time. Until then, you can find us in all the usual places on social media, online, and on our app. Just search for BBC Learning English. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
6 Minute English from BBC Learning English.
Hello, I'm Catherine. Welcome to 6 Minute English, where we engage in some lively debate and discuss 6 stimulating items of vocabulary. And let's start. Here's your cup of coffee, Rob.
Ah, thanks. But what took you so long, Catherine?
Oh, sorry, Rob. I bumped into someone I knew in the cafe and we stopped for a chat.
OK, well, that fits well with today's show, where we're talking about cafes or coffee houses. Did you know, Catherine, that coffee houses were originally a meeting place for lively debate and intellectual discussion?
Really? I didn't know that, Rob. And a debate, by the way, means a discussion that a lot of people take part in. So how long ago was this debating society?
Well, the first coffee house was set up in Oxford in 1650, but they quickly became popular and soon they were all over London too. You paid a penny to get in, and this included access to newspapers and stimulating conversation.
If something is stimulating, it encourages ideas and enthusiasm. And I expect the coffee helped with that a bit, did it?
No, it certainly helps me first thing in the morning.
Which brings me on to today's question, Rob. How many cups of coffee do we consume in coffee shops or stores in the UK every year? Consume, by the way, is another word for eat or drink. So is the answer A, 2.3 million, B, 23 million, or C, 23 billion?
Well, I don't really know, but it's got to be a lot. So I'm going to go for C, 23 billion. That sounds like a lot of coffee, but I buy several cups a week and I expect you do too, Catherine.
I do indeed. But I have to say, while I was getting our coffees earlier, there was nobody else in the cafe talking except me and my friend. Everybody else was sitting on their own, tapping away on their laptops. Let's listen now to Douglas Fraser, BBC Scotland's business and economy editor, describing the vibe, or atmosphere, in a typical 21st century cafe.
10 or so in the morning, the cafe has five people at tables with their backs to the wall, each staring into a screen, plugged in, ears plugged. The flow of bites through this coffee shop's free Wi-Fi is transporting these customers to diverse destinations, far from the person beside them. Collaborative working, a research grant application, a potential blockbuster novel, and inevitably, someone distracted by kitten pictures on social media.
So the spirit of those 17th century coffee houses has disappeared then. No more lively debate and intellectual discussion.
It seems so, Rob. As Douglas Fraser says, many people sit alone, plugged into their laptops, and they're all doing different things. Working, writing, messing about on social media.
And I think the cafe owners should turn off the free Wi-Fi and force these cafe squatters to move on. I don't think people should be allowed to sit all day using the internet, hogging tables and not talking to anybody. Especially when some of them don't even buy coffee.
That's a bit extreme, Rob. Cafe owners need customers and they encourage people to stay by having comfy sofas and newspapers to read and the free Wi-Fi. A squatter, by the way, is someone who lives in an empty building without paying rent. And if you hog something, you use most or all of it in a selfish way.
I suppose you're right, Catherine. Now, how about telling us the answer to today's question then?
OK, so I asked, how many cups of coffee do we consume in cafes or stores in the UK every year? Is it A, 2.3 million, B, 23 million, or C, 23 billion?
Well, I could sit in a cafe using their free Wi-Fi to research the answer, but I had a guess and I said 23 billion.
Well, you didn't need that free Wi-Fi, Rob, because you were absolutely right.
Ah.
23 billion coffees per year works out on average at 45 cups per adult in the UK.
OK, I think it's time we look back at the words we learned today. Our first word is debate, a discussion that a lot of people take part in.
For example, I took part in a number of stimulating debates at school. Number two, if something is stimulating, it encourages new ideas and enthusiasm. For example, it's hard to have a stimulating conversation with someone who's looking at their phone all the time.
That's very true. Let me just slide my phone into my pocket.
There
you go, out of the way. Our next word is consume, another word for eating or drinking, but it can also mean to use. For example, my car consumes a lot of petrol.
Or how do I calculate my car's fuel consumption? So consumption there is the noun. Number four is vibe, which means the mood or atmosphere in a place. For example, Oxford is a city, but it has a small town vibe.
Well, I'm getting bad vibes from our next word, which is squatter. That's someone who lives in an empty building without paying rent. The building is called a squat. So, for example, I lived in a squat for 2 years.
Really? You squatted in a squat, Rob?
No. It was just an example. I am not a squatter.
Oh, so you've never squatted?
No, I haven't. Now, look, we're wasting time here. We need to move on to our final word, hog. If you hog something, you use all or most of it in a selfish way.
For example, Rob, you've hogged the only comfy chair. That's so selfish.
I admit it, Catherine. I'm a chair hog. That's the noun. OK, well, before we head off for another cup of coffee, please remember to check out our Facebook, Twitter and YouTube pages.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
6 Minute English
from BBC Learning English.